introduce our final speaker of the colloquium.
Yes, thank you, Patricia. Hello again to one and all joining with us till now. I'm highly delighted to introduce our last speaker for today's colloquium, who represents a dynamic personality indeed. We have with us now Ankita Sharma, ma'am, who is a digital marketing, communications, and public relations professional specializing in the field of healthcare, education, and social development, corporate communications, public relations, and journalism. She started her career in the year 2010 after completion of her postgraduate degree studies in mass communication from Symbiosis International University, Pune, India. She had done PG diploma in human resource management. She did her bachelor's with honors in education from Cotton University in the year 2008. She has gained a substantial amount of working experience working in different domains of the media and communication sector, starting with internships with cable news network CNN, News 18, and professional career with Doordarshan in the broadcast media field, then shifting to the developmental sector, working with UNICEF and then to corporate communications by working with Fortis Healthcare, New Delhi, and UAE Action Center LLC in Abu Dhabi, United Arab Emirates. She has also been associated with academic pursuits by conducting classes on media and cultural studies and other topics as guest faculty in the Department of Anthropology, Cotton University, and some other educational institutions of Assam as well. So we are eagerly waiting to hear from you, Ankita Sharma, ma'am.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you for this lovely introduction. And I see so many of my revered teachers today watching this symposium. So this topic, learning overseas, is a very broad topic. And so to discuss more on this topic, I have prepared a presentation and I would like to go through it and share the screen with you. One second. Okay, so today the topic that has been given to me is learning overseas with United Arab Emirates as the focus. So basically, United Arab Emirates is a hub of world-class educational institutions and universities. And this country is a relatively new country, which was established in 1971. And it is a federation of seven emirates that we call. In India, the way we have states, so here we have seven emirates, which each of them have hereditary monarchies. So each have their own rulers who set their individual rules, and there are certain rules and regulations placed by the rulers of each emirate. So UAE is basically home to more than about 200 expats, which is much more compared to the native population of UAE, the native population comprises of only 20%. So UAE, as we know, is a home to so many of Indian expats. So besides the Indian expats, there are nationals from more than 200 countries, as I mentioned. And also, so the UAE is also a top study destination of other Gulf countries like Egypt, Jordan, Lebanon, Oman, etc. So now, first, basically, I'd like to give you an overview of what I would like to discuss through my discussion. So first, I would like to take you through the structure of education, how it is prevalent in the United Arab Emirates, the preschooling stage, then the formal schooling stage, how the structure of education is here, right from the nursery level to the class, up to class 12. Then who governs the education system here? There are governing bodies. Then how the university level studies for students, for Indian expats, if they want to pursue studies, if they want to go back to India to pursue studies. So how they will pursue the studies there. I'll give you an overview of that. And also for those students who want to continue studies here in the United Arab Emirates itself, so how they would be pursuing studies here, I would give an overview. And also what are the main scope and areas of learning in the UAE based on the kind of industry and the career that they can choose. Then what kind of provisions of visa is there for students and research scholars? And also what kind of a role the embassy plays? Now, since primarily the target group today is going to be the Indian population, I'm speaking to all Indians, I assume mostly. So I would like to speak on the Embassy of India primarily. And then how, finally, I would like to delve into how learning is being taking place during the time of COVID-19. Okay, so now taking through the first, going through the first slide, the structure of education, the preschooling level. So since I have already mentioned that there are more than 200 nationalities in this country, so it's quite obvious that at the preschool level or the play school or nursery level, there are schools of several curriculum. Even though at the nursery level, they do not follow a particular based curriculum, but there are of course nurseries related to the Indian curriculum. And then there are nurseries following the early years foundation stage, EYFS that we say of UK. Then there is the French curriculum nurseries. Then there are Australian curriculum nurseries. And there are Arabic curriculum nurseries, which come under the Ministry of MOE that we say, Ministry of Education. So the basic aim of these nurseries is to nurture and give them a shape so that they are capable enough for personal development and they can build their own potential as they go forward to the next level of studies in the school level. Then these are the, I have put photos of the kind of activities which are captured. Now this is from my daughter's nursery itself, these photographs. Okay, then coming to the formal schooling. So the formal schooling starts here from 4 years. And same way, like in India, it is divided into primary schooling, then secondary schooling, and higher secondary schooling. Also, the schools here are of several different types. There are Indian schools based on CBSE, ICSE, then there are IB schools, which is the International Baccalaureate. Then there are British schools, there are American schools, there are Canadian schools, German schools, French schools, Italian, Filipino schools, then Bangladeshi schools, Pakistani schools, Iranian, Japanese, Chinese, and also MOE curriculum is also followed here. There are certain schools which are from the Ministry of Education here in the UAE itself. They have their own standard of schools and where the main language is Arabic. The language of instruction is basically Arabic. Likewise, there are also teachers since there are schools from all over the globe. So it's quite obvious that teachers would also be there from a global platform. So there are teachers from all around the globe. And for the teachers too, they have to comply to certain set standards by the government here to qualify to be able to teach as teachers in the schools here. Then we'll talk about the education regulatory bodies here. So like in India, we have the CBSE, Central Board of Secondary Education, and other boards which control the education level till class 12. So here, there we have three basic ed regulatory bodies. The first is the EDEC of Abu Dhabi, Abu Dhabi Department of Knowledge and Education. Then there is KHDA, Knowledge and Human Development Authority of Dubai. Then Sharjah Emirate has their own body, which is the Sharjah Private Education Authority. And so these bodies, they not just look into the entire curriculum-based activities of schools, but they are also entrusted with the responsibility of regulations related to the institutions of higher learning and universities. Also, I would like to mention that in Dubai, there is a particular area which is known as the Dubai Knowledge City, where several of the colleges and higher institutions of learning are all together in one particular place. So it's a great opportunity for students because they have a good opportunity of interacting with university students of different universities and higher education colleges. Then we'll talk about university level studies globally. So as I mentioned that the major expat population here is India, are Indians. So Indians comprise a major population. So Indians, a lot of students after studying here up to the class, up to the 10 plus 2 level, they also go back to the home country. And for that, they are eligible to appear for the Indian entrance level examinations pertaining to STEM, that is science, technology, engineering, mathematics, or medicine, or general studies in the Indian colleges and universities. Also, students who want to pursue studies in abroad in foreign universities, they are also eligible to apply for the universities through the appropriate channels, for example, Scholastic Aptitude Test. Then we'll talk about how the university studies are carried out here in the UAE. So the Ministry of Education, they have very carefully aligned and elevated the quality of higher education of up to international standards. And there are several universities and colleges which are in collaboration with foreign universities and partnerships. So we have several of the universities here, for example, New York University of Abu Dhabi. In Abu Dhabi itself, now just because I live in Abu Dhabi, so I would like to say in Abu Dhabi, there are more than 20 universities of higher learning. So the major ones I would like to include INSEAD of France, then New York University of Technology, then New York University of US, which has a branch here in Abu Dhabi. And then there is the Sorbonne University of Paris, then the Khalifa University, which is a university established here in the UAE itself. It is one of the oldest universities and its rating is quite high when we look into the global standards of rating of the universities. Also in Dubai, they have more than 60 universities or colleges. We have university campuses of Birla Institute of Science and Technology, which is a part of BITS Pilani. Then there is Harriet Watt University, and Manipal University also has a branch here. Michigan State University, they also have a branch here. There is Middlesex University of Dubai, which is a branch of the Middlesex University of UK. Then SP Jain College of Global Management, they have a university here. Then in the UAE, not just in the field of science and technology, there is propagation by the government. There is also propagation by the government in several other fields, like fashion technology, IT, then arts, humanities. So there are several universities of international standards, like ESMOD French Fashion Institute is there. Then London Business School also has a branch here. Then the University of Birmingham, they have a campus here in Dubai. Then University of Wollongong of Australia, they also have a campus here. So these are some of the international foreign universities and colleges that I have mentioned. Besides that, there are higher institutes of learning and education of the particular Emirates itself here. Also, now I would like to take you through the main areas of learning where after study, you would interested aspirants would look into forming a career. So UAE, as we know, is a very oil-rich country, and Abu Dhabi is considered as the main hub of oil and gas. So there is a large pool of aspirants who look into studies related to oil and gas. And there is a specific university, which is called the Petroleum Institute here in Abu Dhabi. It is run in collaboration with the University of Colorado of USA. So they have different specializations of oil-related studies. In fact, I would like to mention, till a few years back, one of our, and I in fact feel it as a very proud moment to say that, one of the heads of the Department of Petroleum Studies, he was an Assamese, Hemanta Sharma. He has migrated now to Canada. So he had been handling the Department of Petroleum Studies till a few years back. Also, Dubai, as we know, is the main hub of all commercial activities. So there are several manufacturing and service industry related units in Dubai, Sharjah, and other industrial areas. So Boeing, they also facilitate in producing their parts. Then Ashok Leyland, they also produce equipments and vehicles, which are done here in UAE itself. Also the government here, they have been carrying out several activities related to space science research. Very recently it has started, and very recently in July 2020, the HOPE probe Mars mission was launched. So this is one field where a lot of innovation is going on, which is being carried out by the government here. Also, in the field of artificial intelligence and digitalization, a lot of work is going on. In fact, there is a separate ministry of artificial intelligence and digitalization, which looks into the innovation related affairs in this sector. Also, there is Masdar University, which carries out several kind of sustainable related activities using renewable energy, alternative energies, water energy, hydro energy. So several experiments are carried out, and we can see implementation of those activities in several of the coming up fields out here. Also, which relates to art, music, and literature, there is great propagation by the government here. The Louvre, which was the Louvre of Paris, a lot of you must have heard, the Louvre Museum of Paris. So they have, the government here have set up the Louvre Museum in Abu Dhabi also. And so there is a lot of propagation related to art, music, literature, for people who are interested in these sectors. Also, I would like to mention that the dairy sector here is really coming up. A lot of work is being done, and the government itself is carrying out several innovative ways of coming up with the technology related to the dairy sector. And I have to mention here that we get very good dairy-related products here in the UAE, which is a produce of UAE itself. Very good milk, then cottage cheese, yogurt, and other products, and which are also sent across to other countries. Then I would like to speak on for students who would be interested in coming over for study and research related activities in the UAE. So there is a provision of 5-year residency visa for foreign university graduates. Besides that, there is also a 1-year visa or extended visa opportunity for students who would like to come over for study and research related activities. Now, it also depends on the universities, the particular universities that they would like to carry forward their studies with. So also exceptionally talented students, they are granted a 10-year residency visa. So that is a great scope of learning and experimenting for students and researchers. And also there is scope of a variety of scholarships for international students. Next, I would like to speak on the role of the embassy here. So this is an advice for any student who would like to pursue any kind of studies or research related activities, be it in anywhere around the globe. It would be a good advice to keep in touch with the embassy, because you know embassy is a medium through which your status of being in that foreign nation is counted. Also, now I have been here for more than 7 years. So in these 7 years, I have noticed that the embassy here plays a very strong role. I have also been actively involved with several of the activities that are being carried out by the embassy here. They carry out several programs from time to time for propagation and promotion of our country's rich heritage and culture. So I have also participated from time to time in several of these competitions, quiz competitions, essay competitions and all, and I've won prizes also. So these are good ways and a boost for us expats who are living away from our native land. So with this, I almost come to the end of the discussion before I make this discussion more interactive. So now the next question that would come is, how is learning being taken forward during the time of COVID? So the academic year here starts from the month of September. So so very soon the academic year would be starting. And this year we've noticed that options are being given, whether the students want to pursue their studies through the online mode, or would they like to go there and be on site and carry out their studies. So So now most of the parents and students, they have opted for the online mode, looking at the prevailing conditions. So virtual learning and distance learning is right now the mode that we can think of that is going to be continued. Besides that, for those people, for those students who would opt for classroom learning, for them, they would have to be extra cautious because they would have to be equipped with masks, hand sanitizers, and gloves. And it is mandatory by the government here. The rules are extremely strict. So with that, I come to the end of this discussion. I hope you were enriched. I hope it was knowledgeable enough for you. So I'm open for any kind of questions. If anyone has any kind of questions, I'm open for any kind of questions. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am, for your interesting presentation. It discussed prominent areas like administration and areas of learning at different levels of education in UAE, which I'm sure our participants have found very relevant. You have given actually a comprehensive and systematic outlook towards educational opportunities in UAE. A few questions are there from the participants I'd like to put forward to you. There's a question from Ehsanul Haq Fahim. He's asking, what are the government scholarships provided by the UAE government?
By the UAE government. See, basically, the government here, they are very careful in protecting the rights of their own natives. Because as I earlier mentioned, that the natives, the local population only consists of 20%. So for students who would be interested to pursue any kind of education here, now every study, whatever, it would depend on the kind of study that they would like to pursue. And also there are different scholarships and such kind of recognitions, depending on the university they select. So whichever university or college they would aim at, so on the basis of that, they would have to check the website or they would have to get in touch with the campus coordinator, and that is how they would get a comprehensive idea of what kind of scholarships would be available for foreign nationals who would be interested to study over here.
Okay, thank you for the detailed answer. And one more question has come from a participant. He's asking, what are the challenges in UAE for getting a degree? Are there any challenges for an Indian student?
For an Indian student, the challenges, there, I wouldn't say challenges, it would be up on the student, how they are going to pursue up or what kind of a line they would. What I would say is that the kind of education here is of world-class standards, because a lot of the programs are in collaboration and partnerships. In fact, even the local universities and institutions of higher learning, they have, after a certain semester, you know, there are programs which, including internships and all, which they do in collaboration with foreign universities or even Indian universities, I would say. For example, in Manipal, for their management-related programs, they do carry out certain collaborations with Indian Institute of Technology, IIM, with IIMs also. So there are such kind of provisions also. So that way, those are very good opportunities. So yeah, so that is it. That's about it. I hope I could answer. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us and enriching the session with your knowledge and communication skills. We are very much happy to have you with us. Thank you.
Thank you so much. It was lovely to go forward with the session. Thank you so much.
We have come towards the end of the colloquium, and I request joint convener, Dr. Torali Pathak, ma'am, to offer the vote of thanks. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. It's my privilege that I have been asked to propose the vote of thanks. On behalf of the Department of Education, Cotton University, I extend a very hearty vote of thanks to our guests and speakers for sharing your experiences and ideas with us. A big thanks to our respected registrar sir, Professor Digonto Kumar Das sir, who took up time from his busy schedule and inspired us through your presence. Sir has rightly expressed that in the present time, we need to extend our knowledge beyond boundaries. Your presence is a blessing for us, sir. Thank you so much. I want to offer my sincere gratitude to Dr. Kyoko Mary Toyama, ma'am, Professor Counseling, LaGuardia Community College, City University, New York, for her gracious presence and her insight on the opportunity and scope of studying psychology in US and extending knowledge on various career options in psychology and resolving the queries asked by our students or participants in the chat box also. It's an honor to have you with us now. I also wish to express my gratitude to Dr. Gurumani Goswami sir for his valuable speech on Indian higher education system and possibilities and probabilities of making Indian education system as part of the global standard and attracting more foreign students in our country. Your presence always gives us strength and positivity. Thank you so much, sir. We are grateful to Ms. Ananya Bordoloi for sharing her experiences on applying for masters in Germany and various technicalities associated. I am sure our students are greatly benefited by your experience. Thank you so much. I may like to express our sincere thanks to Ms. Ankita Sharma, who is a Cottonian and an alumnus of our department, for her interesting speech and insights on learning opportunities in UAE, the structure of various stages of education. You have explained so beautifully and in detail. We'd like to hear more from you all in the coming days also. Thank you so much. I would like to offer our sincere gratitude to Dr. Biran Rupal, Secretary ICT Cell, Assam College Librarians Association, for his constant support, without whose support this colloquium wouldn't have been possible. Thank you so much, sir. I would like to offer my gratitude to our HOD ma'am, Dr. Julie Mohanto ma'am, who is so supportive and always encourages us to do something. Thank you, ma'am. I would like to say thanks to Funu ma'am, because she is the one who always leads us in our every endeavor. Thank you, ma'am. I would also like to offer my thanks to Pratisha Padmashri Dekha for taking all the initiatives and arranging everything for the smooth functioning of the colloquium. I would like to thank Dr. Meena Kumari Devi ma'am, Dr. Angita Sharma Borua ma'am, and Dr. Nita Baglari ma'am, Dr. Smriti Rekha Phukan for their constant support and encouragement. And last but not the least, I would like to offer my gratitude to all the participants for your kind presence and tips. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Dr. Tarali ma'am, for always being a vital part of the colloquium and extending your kind cooperation and support whenever required. With this, we wind up our knowledgeable and interesting colloquium and wish each and every one of you a safe and healthy days ahead. A big thank you to one and all. Thank you.